Time to get woke. Now available in paperback and Kindle Unlimited, John Haynes, the man with nothing to lose, the man who rules the world, runs to the irresistible force of a man with nothing to lose in this action-packed, all-new John Haynes series adventure. Get the regular and variant editions of John Haynes, the man with nothing to lose, on Amazon.com today. Marvel Comics is trying to show how woke it is with its new New Warriors comic book. And this relaunch of New Warriors is more about promoting so-called diversity and identity politics instead of giving us the action-packed storytelling readers got back in 1989 when the New Warriors first appeared in those two issues of the Mighty Thor and helped him overcome the Juggernaut. And what's really troubling about this new Warriors comic is that we're not getting anything unique as related to storytelling, because according to Daniel Kibblesmith, the white male who is going to be writing the New Warriors comic, the premise for the 2020 New Warriors is about the old New Warriors team helping to mentor the new young New Warriors team. Now, where have we seen that premise before? Oh, yeah, it was in Geoff Johns' Teen Titans back in about 2004-2005. So, your Daniel Kibblesmith, the white male, who is writing the so-called diverse New Warriors in 2020, is not doing anything really original with the concept of the New Warriors as related to story, concept, or premise. Instead, he is focusing on these brand new so-called woke heroes. And when I take a critical examination of these so-called woke heroes created by this white male, I can see the passive-aggressive racism being presented to me. For example, when I look at this character Trailblazer, and I notice how they have made her the representation of obesity, I find it interesting that you have the obese character being a black woman. So, passively, you're going to give me a black female heroine, but aggressively, you're going to promote the stereotype that black women are fat. So basically, this character is a passive-aggressive slap at black women. You're saying that the only way for a black woman to be accepted into a group of superheroes is for her to be the stereotypical fat black female. Now, this female has this magical backpack, and that's, as I see it, a pretty lame power, because it's not really about showing us her learning how to use her powers on her own. So this is just, again, another way for them to promote a stereotype underhandedly at us while all preaching the so-called diversity at us. Now, the second character's screen time is supposed to be one of these kids who is plugged into the internet all the time. And again, another shallow character that really doesn't give us any sort of story or character development. He's basically just there to be an information dump as related to the probably weak storytelling, because many of these woke comics oftentimes feature some of the weakest storytelling, and his job is just to move the plot along with information dumps, because the writer really did not think about things like plot, character development, or creating sort of conflicts and obstacles for these heroes to overcome. So he's exposed to an internet gas, one of the most puerile concepts I've ever heard of, and he's patched into the World Wide Web. Well, what happens when somebody hits him with an electromagnetic pulse? Does he lose all of his powers? That's how poorly developed that character is. But SJW creators, they really don't think about things as related to strengths and weaknesses of characters and how they can overcome those strengths and weaknesses. Now, after we get with the internet character and the stereotypical fat black female, we get Snowflake and Safe Space. And both of these woke characters still further perpetuate more of the racism that is passive-aggressively being presented to readers in this story. Now, your Snowflake, the female in New Warriors, this time is another passive-aggressive jab at black women. And your Snowflake is supposed to be this non-binary character, and again, this is another passive-aggressive attack on black women, because what they're trying to say is they're trying to desexualize this black female character, just like they did with the obese character, so that she won't appear to be as attractive in the face of women in the book, like Nae Merida and Firestar, the white females in the book, so that they can appear to be more attractive by in comparison, because if we asexualize or make it where they are, the black women are less attractive, readers won't see them as somebody that they want to be a fan of. So basically, what they want to do with this Trailblazer and Snowflake is take away their ability to be sexual characters and take away their sexuality so that the white female characters can appear more attractive to be comparison. Again, another passive-aggressive attack on black characters and black sexuality so that the white characters can appear to be the ones that you need to be seen as attractive and desirable. And with this Safe Space character, there is another attack on black manhood, black masculinity, and black men, and black men, because with this character, again, we have another passive-aggressive attack on black manhood, because this character is dressed in an effeminate outfit, he's wearing pink, and he is being presented as some sort of safe space, basically saying that he is some sort of beta male, not an alpha male, because the team is led primarily by this Trailblazer character, the big, fat, black woman. So this whole team is basically a racist dig at black people, and it's supposed to be about so-called diversity, but I can see the racism between the lines of these designs and the racism between the lines of this story. Now, the last character, many of my darkly inclined and goth viewers, you should really take offense to this B negative, because this B negative, really, I don't see much as related to a goth aesthetic to this character. Now, they're trying to say that he's the goth kid, but it's clear to me that they didn't really do much research on the goth subculture like I did for the Spinsterella trilogy. And they're saying, oh, he got a blood transfusion, now he's got some vampire powers, but if you're into the goth scene, you know that it's not about anything as related to vampires, that it's more about the music, and the aesthetic, again, would not just be some sort of basic vampire powers and having a so-called bad attitude, because people in the goth scene, they really frustrates them when people say that they have these bad attitudes and that they're moody. When I've met, again, many people in the goth scene, and they are very chill, they are very relaxed, and they're some of the kindest people out here, and here we have this writer perpetuating stereotypes about people in the goth scene, and not really even understanding what the foundation of the goth subculture is, which is the music. And when I look at this aesthetic, where it looks really uninspired, and it really does not present a actual goth aesthetic, it's just really basically about promoting a stereotype, it really isn't about really, again, showing me a character that will show me all of the richness, the multidimensionality, and the layers that are out here that a craftsman would do or craftsperson would do. He's all about creating these so-called colorful characters, personality clashes, and I don't really see him really crafting a solid story, because he's all about showing how woke he is with these new warriors, but not really trying to tell us a great story. And that's the big problem with many of these woke comics out here. It's all about virtue signaling to the world that they're all about promoting diversity. But the great irony is that they show how racist these companies like Marvel Comics are. Because here we have your Daniel Kibblesmith again, a white male writing a story of the New Warriors, a team that is supposed to be all about diversity, but the great irony is it's all about promoting stereotypes that are a part of our culture. And again, I find it interesting that Marvel Comics, in its efforts to talk about how woke they are and how they are all about so-called diversity, still don't have any black writers or writers of color on their creative team. Because writers like myself, who have been out here for years, it seems like Marvel Comics can't seem to find us, even though your Sana Amana, the Vice President of Content and Character Development, says that if we want to find these so-called talented black writers and writers of color, they would go out here and find them. And again, I have been here for over 10 years blogging, and there are numerous samples of my work online for people to see. And I know I could do a better job with the New Warriors than this Daniel Kibblesmith, and I would not be out here making so these woke characters like this, which are basically passive-aggressive jabs meant to promote old racist stereotypes. No, what I would do is use the already established New Warriors and continue on with their story. Because the original New Warriors was an already diverse team with a black man, Night Thrasher, leading the team. He was at his side was Silhouette, his girlfriend, a black woman. Rage, a black man, was on the team. You had an Atlantean named Arita on the team. You had a white male, Nova. You had Firestar. You had Marvel Boy. You had Darkhawk. And again, all established characters in the Marvel Universe, which already showed us how diverse the Marvel Universe is. And if you wanted to add a little bit more diversity, you would go get Kamala Khan, Ms. Marvel, and put her on this team of New Warriors. And you would go out here and get Silk and put her on this team of New Warriors. Because the original New Warriors was one of the most diverse teams out here. And when I look at all of these heroes that are already created and established, all you had to do was form that new team, and with these new characters, again, like your Kamala Khan, Ms. Marvel, your Unstoppable Wasp, your Hope Van Dyne, or go out here and get Silk, and you would have a diverse team already set up, and all you have to do is set up some sort of menace for them to take on and overcome. So the concept was already solid, but Marvel Comics, because their editorial is lazy and what they want to do is try to generate sales through controversy, what they want to do is go out here and create some sort of woke concept to get people talking on social media like I am right now, instead of trying to do the hard work that writers did back in 1989 during the Acts of Vengeance storyline, where they set up that the first appearance of the New Warriors in, I believe, Thor 411 and 412, where he took on the Juggernaut and introduced this fantastic superhero team, then gave them their own book, which I believe ran into the high 90s or even the hundreds, I believe. So the concept is solid. Unfortunately, the concept in this case isn't solid. And like West Coast Avengers, which came before it, I don't expect the woke warriors to go much longer than maybe 8 issues or 10 issues at best. And the reason why it's not going to go the distance is because this team was not really designed with anything as related to storytelling, nor was it designed as related to anything as related to powers or how those powers would work together in a dynamic. It's basically a slapdashed, rehashed version of Geoff Johns' Teen Titans. And sadly, Geoff Johns did a better job with this 15 years ago than what your new writer, Daniel Kibblesmith, is going to try to do with it right now. Because your Geoff Johns, back in the day, was looking to create a concept based on showing how the older heroes of the new Teen Titans were going to mentor the Young Justice characters and help them become Titans, actually graduating those characters up to the next level, and showing us how these characters were getting ready to take that next step. Now, I wasn't really agreeing with the whole idea of making the Young Justice Teen Titans, because I thought Young Justice had found its niche, Young Justice had found its voice, and the Titans franchise had been struggling ever since the Judas contract had ended. So I really thought that what would really help to refresh the Titans concept would be Young Justice, because when Dan Jurgens tried to do the new Teen Titans with Origin and Johto and Risk, yeah, the books were actually very good. When I read all of the books for Dan Jurgens' Teen Titans, they were very good, but they weren't the Teen Titans. He did a good job of the execution of the concept and stayed true to the roots, but the big problem was they weren't the teen sidekicks, and Young Justice had the teen sidekicks, and that's why Young Justice took off. But then Geoff Johns wanted to rebrand Young Justice as Teen Titans, but as I see it again, I would rather have them as Young Justice. But I know I'm rambling on a tangent, but when I look at New Warriors, it pales in comparison to what Geoff Johns did with Teen Titans. It really isn't being executed well. And the reason why it isn't being executed well is because your Marvel Comics would rather virtue signal and show how woke they are. And because they want to show how woke they are, what they're going to do is make Marvel Comics go broke one more again. Now, if you want to pick up some of my stories featuring heroes and heroines, like the Isis series, the E-Steam series, or the books in the John Haynes series, like the new John Haynes, The Man with Nothing to Lose, you can pick up those books on Amazon.com in paperback and Kindle formats. And you can find many of those stories featuring black heroes and heroines not only on Amazon.com in paperback and Kindle format, but you can find them on digital platforms like Smashwords, the iBookstore, and Barnes & Noble. And if you want to see me make more videos about comics, you can donate to my Patreon, my PayPal, or my Cash App so that I can continue talking about comics, reviewing comics, and talking about them regularly. That's all I have to say for this video. You can comment, rate, and subscribe.
Now available in paperback and e-readers, Isis, My Sister, My Frenemy. It's a sister act as the goddess next door and the devilish diva team up in this action-packed Isis series adventure. Get Isis, My Sister, My Frenemy in paperback and e-readers everywhere.